Sending military flights late at night over the neighborhood. You know, George Jones used to sing like his life depended upon it, and it actually did. His father was a raging alcoholic, violent, and he would come home at night and wake up everybody and start, you know, beating up the children, the wife, and it was just terrible. And the only way to stop him and from his rage, drunken rages, would be George Jones singing a song for him. So George would have to sing for his dad and for hours sometimes, and to keep his brothers and sisters and mother from getting beaten. And if he didn't sing good, they would get beaten. So he literally put his total heart and soul into it to save others, you know, like not only his life depended on it, but others' lives depend on it. He's saying that way. You can hear it when you hear him sing, say, my God, that guy's like singing like, you know, someone's life depends on it. It's true. Whoa. And so I'm taping like my life depends on it, or other people's lives depend upon it. That's how I feel. Absolutely true. So I try to give everything I've got to it. I really feel that people's lives depend upon it. The world is a terrible place, to put it very mildly. We cling to severe problems. This whole world's a death-based training program. It's a way of trying to forget what reality is and to suffer deprivation and death and sickness and all these horrible mental afflictions and fears, etc. And we cling to all of that, and we won't give it up. Why? I know why. See, I do know exactly why. Because we're more afraid of the continuity problem than we are of all these afflictions. That is a fact. You can totally bank on that fact. We are more afraid of an abrupt loss of all problems than we are any particular problems. We say, well, I'd rather have this cancer than to lose all problems abruptly. Fact. That is a fact. So there is no way to cure anything in this world, really, except to have the continuity problem resolved. With this, in other words, to have an intermediate step between problems, death-based training program of deprivation, etc., and no problems at all, which is reality. An intermediate step that reminds us of reality but doesn't take away the potentiality for problems. So in other words, we keep all the form, we still see the world and its potentiality for problems, but we don't feel any problems at all. Everything's completely smoothed out, but the potential is still there. You see, there's a difference. Whereas in reality, there's not even any potential for problems, none. Unless we choose to try and be greater than God, which is what we did, which is why we have this problem right now. So, literally, recognizing the continuity problem is the only problem we have, and tuning into it, valuing the solution to it, which is this vision of oneness, which leaves the potential for problems, except there aren't any, just the potential. That literally frees us from all problems. It frees us from cancer. It frees us from every sickness. It frees us from every death. It frees us from death. It frees us from the totality of all problems: confusion, terror, sick, loneliness, insecurity, all the inner fears that we harbor, which are almost numberless, really, and all the afflictions that the flesh is heir to, the whole entire thing, we're freed from all of that in exchange for just the potential for problems. And the potential is never utilized. It's just there to reassure us that if God suddenly turns crazy, if we can run back to problems. So this is a very clear way of putting it. We exchange all these problems for merely the potential for problems. Except there aren't any. Completely smoothed out. We feel our spirit totally smoothed out. So this is a great way to explain the entire situation of salvation. It's that simple. There's nothing else to add to it, really. And so, focusing on the continuity problem and its resolution is the path to salvation, period. And without that, you're going to continue to suffer. You're going to suffer problems, for sure. Because that's how we hide from God. You know, it's how we distract ourselves away from the fear of God. It's how we cling, how we try to deal with the continuity problem. We're so scared of it. We're so intimidated by it. And we project it onto God, our own desire to dispossess God of everything. We think God's trying to dispossess us of everything. So we say, well, we know we have a continuity problem, but we're going to solve it. We're going to keep God out of it because we're afraid of God. So we apply our own methods to the continuity problem, which is a disaster for us. Which is what we call the ego, which is essentially saying, let's just stay here forever. Let's just make this world a utopia. The world of impermanence, let's make it a utopia so we really love it. And so we never have to drop this dream of forgetfulness. And so there is no continuity problem. That's what most people in the world are actually working on and doing. They're trying to turn this world into a utopia. But everything still remains, all the impermanence, all the problems, all the instabilities. I mean, the Earth is a very unstable place, actually. Out here in California, you know, as we're enjoying this incredible weather, well, they're about ready to declare a large area of California an extreme drought area, which never has happened before in the history of California. That declaration has never, ever been made, and they're about ready to do it. And we've had like 13 months plus of no rain. It's the driest 13 months in recorded history here in California. And we're all getting really very, very concerned, with very good reason to be concerned, actually. This isn't some little state. This is a state that is absolutely crammed with people and population. And for a drought to hit this area is very serious news. Yeah, we got some rain. Like a 7/100ths of an inch of rain yesterday. That's the first rain we've had in a long, 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 long time. 7/100ths of an inch. So the world is not stable. I mean, they got the cold and stuff down in the south, and you know, it's in constant, impermanent flux. It's not stable. Nothing is stable in this whole dream of impermanence and instability, which is a dream of forgetfulness of reality. That's its whole purpose. And you can't have a purpose, without having the effects align with that idea. So the notion of making a utopia here is completely nuts. Completely nuts. Besides, the ego doesn't want to solve the continuity problem. It only wants to fake like it's solving it. Because it believes God wants to destroy us. So why would the ego resolve a continuity problem so we could go back to reality, where it thinks that we're going to be destroyed? No, what the ego is doing is putting on a pretense, pretending to be interested in solving it, but not really solving it at all. And going the opposite direction, actually, of solving it, making us more and more and more miserable. Now, the way, what our part in this is to give up the totality of our dream to the Holy Spirit, the dream, our dream, hand that over to the Holy Spirit and say, here you go. Now, why would we do that? Wouldn't we fear an abrupt change then? The answer is no, thanks to the Holy Spirit. What the Holy Spirit does is it gives back to us the resolution to the continuity problem. It gives us back the potential for problems without any actual problems. So that is what happens. So we don't, you know, lose our potential for problems at all. It's not like the Holy Spirit says, aha, I finally got all your problems, you gave them to me now, I'm not going to give you any of them at all, and I'll take them all away and never, you know, not like that, no. That would be trickery, not that way. So that's what I've seen, is you get back what you need, what the Holy Spirit knows is, and as far as your own life goes, you get back whatever you need to have continuity in your life in some way. And it discards all the stuff that you don't need, that's not good for you, not helpful, whatever. That's discarded. All the junk. It's like you do a complete defragmentation of your hard disk. Perfect, flawless, beautiful defragmentation. Everything runs smooth. Your system runs smooth. Everything's fast, smooth, smoothed out in a spiritual way. That is what we're headed for. And that's what I'm trying to do, is just give it all, everything. Here's the totality of the whole dream of me, and do with it whatever you want. It's in your hands now. And it's a matter of trust. And what we have a hard time is, we have a hard time trusting the Holy Spirit, for sure. Very, very difficult time doing that. Because of our projection. Because we're so used to projecting our trickery onto God, we have a hard time believing that God is not trying to trick us. So we have to reach this. You know, we realize we're on the same page, and all is well. You know, we've repented. We've said yes. This is what we tried to do. We understand it. We tried to project, and we're willing to drop all the projection and remember reality. And so it's not a pie in the sky thing at all. It's very down to earth, very reasonable, very pragmatic, what we're trying to do here. With urgency, actually. I've got so much urgency, my nerves are just about fried, because the black swan event is coming for sure, which is an unexpected event that just tips the mark. What I've seen, people ask, how do you know this stuff? Many dreams, many foreshadowing, very clearly about a massive dumping of stocks. There's going to be a massive stock dump. Very massive. Is it maybe some black swan event? Something is going to trigger a massive stock dump. And the thing is, once it gets going, the psychology of humans right now is such that projection will run rampant. And once this whole mechanism of projection gets going, you can't stop it. You get a panic. So it, unfortunately, it's within the makeup of our, the dynamic of me, which is based on projection, dishonesty and projection, fear of God, guilt, you know, insecurity, mistrust, trying to forget reality, and all this stuff. It's within that strange brew that panics can occur. And I saw this incredible stock dump. Everything was just dumped. It was a complete mess. I was able to escape the whole thing, but only through incredible efforts. And I was really tired. I climbed out of this valley, and a valley of where all the stocks were dumped into this valley, and I got out of it. I was like winded, like, oh boy, that was a tremendous effort. So right now I'm very winded, very tired of just going full blast, because I know that it's coming soon. It is coming soon. And there's a lot of people very confident, but I tell you, it's the confident ones that will flip into panic. It's not interesting. I talked to a doctor today, neurologist, a neurosurgeon today. I asked him about Michael Schumacher, and he says, I think that he's not in an induced coma anymore. He's out of it. He's just in a coma, period. And that's why there's a news blackout on Schumacher. There's no news at all of what's going on. And it's all just complete speculation. He says you can only stay in an induced coma about eight to ten days. You can't keep him in any longer. He's in a coma. So yeah, it's from a professional there saying that. I don't know, but the economy, the world situation, as the cat moves around. Come on, relax. You know, there could already be troubles that they already know. You know, it could be that they already know what the deal is. you see? Could very well be true, right? I mean, there could be those in the world who know that the economy is kaput. They know it. They may have known it for quite some time. They may have suspected it for quite some time, and now they may actually have evidence that it's kaput. But the world there's a blackout thing. So everybody's speculating. Say, well, there's hope. You know, hopefully things will be great. Hopefully things will be good. But I don't think so. So literally, we need to have this miracle of living a life here where there's only potential for problems, and yet there aren't any problems happening, at least in our life. Our presence, and the presence of this carefree, no smoothed out, no problemness here, has this enormous, actually, resonance with the world. I think Ramana Maharshi said that a true adept can be sitting in a cave and nobody even knows they're in the world, and they can have an enormous positive boost effect on the whole planet, the whole world. Even nobody even knows they're here, never even say a word. So those who do receive this, recognize it, and turn over their whole story of me to the Holy Spirit and get back this only a potential of problems here, will have a calming effect on the world, very much a calming effect. And those who want to be calm will gravitate towards that, and those who don't will gravitate away from that. So you're going to have a settling out of different stratifying of different attitudes here in the world. Very soon there's going to be the stratification, and it will happen automatically. This is what part of what I call the ascension process. Like you shake oil and vinegar together and it looks like it's all some one thing, and then it stratifies and you realize that there's oil and then there's vinegar, that kind of thing. Cream rises to the top in milk, for instance. So there will be this change coming where this stratification will take place. And then there'll be different futures for these people. Be third, some will continue third dimensional, some fourth dimensional, some fifth dimensional. Fifth dimensional being kind of an open-ended dimension that actually, where zero dimensionality is realized. So we absolutely have to make it our business to succeed with this. There's no option. Failure is not an option. It's like George Jones singing. He said, you know, I got to sing good. I got to sing really good. It's not an option to sing lousy. Don't want my brothers and sisters to get beat up on. And he was the youngest, just had the capacity. So we certainly don't want our brothers and sisters in this world to get beat up on by the turmoil that is to come. You don't want them to get beat up on by problems, all because they don't recognize the continuity problem for what it is. And that the fact that it's been resolved by God, that all because of that, that's the only reason that anyone need suffer at all, is they cling to the suffering that they've invented for themselves. All suffering's an invention, it's a whimsical fantasy, actually. And we cling to it because we're more afraid of having all problems disappear. That's what we're terrified of. We're way more terrified of that than we are of a gruesome death. Way more terrified. Of course we don't like a gruesome death. Of course we don't like suffering. But we're way more scared of abruptly losing all suffering and feeling displaced, a severe displacement, a severely abrupt displacement. Like, wow, no problems, no problems. Whoa, wait, what's going on? What am I? Who am I? Why? See, we're terrified of that. So we'll put ourselves through any amount of torture and suffering just to avoid losing all suffering. But so God understands this, sees it, knows it, and gives the superficial potentiality for problems. In other words, the forms, everything still remains, except everything's completely smoothed out, and there isn't any spiritual suffering at all taking place. You feel it's a total smooth oneness, smoothed out oneness. It's only one, just this oneness, and it's not suffering at all. And yet, perceptually, the potential for problems seems to still be, you know, remain sort of a faint possibility, as it were. Potential, a faint potentiality, seems to still be there. And so you're not without, the whole complex of problems just don't abruptly disappear, and you don't feel displaced. So it's a flawless, perfect remedy. And we better be aware of the flawless, perfect remedy before all the problems come down, raining down on our heads here. You see, the world's enlisted the help of the interlopers, the clever, deceitful ones, who are experts at generating problems for a planet. And they said, "Hey, help, 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 help! I feel like maybe we're in danger of getting enlightened on this planet. We need to desperately need to have our problems intensified here. We don't want to lose all our problems. So we've allowed this world to brought in these experts in generating problems, and they know their business. They know their business, and they will certainly manage to generate a whole boatload of problems here." They've been working on it night and day here, as a matter of fact. They take pride in their work and their business in succeeding in generating worldwide problems. Sowing the seeds of discord and chaos here. And that's what's been going on. So we don't want to get caught up in that. We want to have to be aware of the flawless, perfect remedy that God has for us, which requires, of course, that we recognize projection for what it is, and recognize that we have projected our motives onto God. Okay, our motives of trying to dispossess God of everything reality, we projected that onto God, and said that God's trying to deprive us of everything, so we don't trust God, don't trust the remedy He has for us. We have to recognize that for sure. Projection, recognizing projection is very important. But just as enough just to recognize and say, okay, and there's no reason then to fear the Prime Creator. And then we don't no reason to fear the Prime Creator's remedy for us either, right? And then we can accept it. So, but there is this fear of, like, now, the idea of irreversibility, fear of irreversibility. Of once we take this step, we can never reverse it. Well, actually, all we're doing with this step is recognizing and remembering that reality itself is irreversible. There is no reversibility of reality. It's merely just being aware of that fact. That's all. The potential for reversibility, the problem of believing in reversibility, is still present. The potential's still there. It's just that we say, well, it's very difficult and it's very faint potential, etc. But it still potentially seems to be there, all the while we're remembering that reality cannot be reversed. Cannot be reversed. We can't reverse reality. We can't change reality at all. And we're just abiding in that remembrance with the faint potential that, well, maybe I see the way that I could work, might, you know, possible work on it, you know, all this form, all this world. Gives you that vague sense, maybe it's plausible, vague sense of plausibility, vague potential sense of plausibility is a way to put it. But coming up, there's not going to be any way to fake it. There's a lot of fakers in the world right now. Always has been, always will be. It's part of the whole deal here. And there's a lot of those who use, I could go into great depth about that, but let's just say it's going to separate the wheat from the chaff. It's going to, those who have really gotten the vision of oneness, that will become apparent in the days ahead. And those who say they have but don't will become apparent too. It will become apparent. The wheels will come off. The wheels will come off. Because they don't have the presence to calm people down, really. They really don't. They really don't. But all is forgiven. It's just part of the whole deal here. You know, there's no blame, or we don't need to hurl anger or blame in anybody. That's just one way that we act out our fear of the continuity problem, is the fake teachers, the fake gurus, those who claim they're enlightened and are really not. That they're mixing in a lot of human nature stuff, a lot of playing the role of the mother and the little girl and the princess and the little daughter and this, all these various roles. But they're not really enlightened. They're using those to make you kind of overlook the fact that they're not enlightened, actually. That can happen here a lot. And people are willing to, you know, they like people to fake things because they themselves want to fake. They want to fake out God. So they say, yeah, they really like great fakers here, actually. But in the time that's to come, they're not going to like fakers anymore. Because then the fakers will just say, ah, forget it. You know, this is too much. I'm out of this business. Yeah, people, whoa, what's going on? You know. And there'll be bad situations to come. There'll be cults to come, very bad suicidal cults to come in the world, all this kind of stuff. And so, you know, but those who actually do have the vision of oneness, who have the smoothed out sameness, and have no problems at all, only the faint, plausible potential for problems, people will recognize that and say, "Wow, hey, this is legit. This is legit. This is the resonance is there." So it'll be an interesting time for sure. And of course, I have made no claims that I'm enlightened whatsoever. In fact, I've said just the opposite. I'm absolutely not. Haven't done it yet. But I'm working on it, which is what everybody should be doing. So there's nothing wrong with people who are working on it to share that with others, that they're working on it. Let them know, hey, I'm working on it, you can work on it too. You know, I'm trying to get there, you can, you know, try to get there too. You know, when the time's to come, all the jewelry and beautiful clothes and luxurious houses, all that stuff, it's not going to be enough. The image isn't going to be enough. Image will not be enough in the times to come. No way. It's not enough ever, but people think they can work with it. You know, hey, this is something I can work with. But in the times that are come, they say, this just doesn't pass muster at all. What was that Indian guru, that lady? She couldn't maintain the farce, the fraud, the pretense, set herself on fire, you know, just burned herself to death. She was a big time guru over there, and it just all unraveled. Didn't have the real goods, and couldn't keep up the pretense. And there's a lot of that, actually. There's an enormous attitude in the world today of this fake assurance. This whole, what is it, self-empowerment or self-esteem movement, this all is to build up this kind of fake confidence, you know, that hey, we're radiating assurance and stuff. No way. It's all going to be unmasked very soon. So expect that and don't wait for it. You know, keep turning your attention to preparing and going towards the whole resolution of the continuity issue. being the way that we are, the fear being so strong, I'm sure we're going to play it very up to the very close, you know. That's the way we are. Play it to the last, procrastinate to the last second or whatever. And then, you know, get it done. Get it done. I think I'll get it done. But probably just at the last moment or so. Hopefully a little bit ahead of time. But, you know, we really have a reluctance. There's no question about it. We're afraid of this, you know, it seems like a total commitment, like we're committed. But we have to keep working through that and see just what a minor issue it is, actually. Because, again, the potential for problems will still be there. We're just remembering that reality can't be reversed. It was just a fact. So what are we losing, really? Just a delusion that reality could be reversed or changed or something. That's all. Never was true. So what are we losing? What's irreversible? It's not like we're losing something as an irreversible change. No, we're just recognizing what was always irreversible. So continue to train your attention towards what you know has real value to you by using the no value when your thoughts arise. No value and no value there. No value there. No value there. Stop the train of thoughts right away. No value there when you start to see it. Keep it from turning into some kind of inner narration. Stop him. No, there's no value there. Only the vision of oneness has value. Only the intermediate step. The resolution of the continuity issue has value. And say, I don't have a future problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have any future problem whatsoever. I only have a continuity problem. Deny the entire future as far as problematically goes. The problematic nature of the future, I don't have a future problem. I only have a continuity problem. That's it. That's the only problem I have is a continuity problem. Keep up those techniques. Keep it simple and say, no value, and I don't have a future problem. I have a continuity problem. Continuity problem is the only problem there is. It's the only problem I have. It's the only problem there is. Just keep hammering away at that. It's being very effectual in my case. I'm making rapid progress, actually. Even though I'm very nervous, making rapid progress and tired. Of course, it's stressful. But at certain times, when you get near the end of a race, you gotta try to finish as fast as possible. In this case, we're getting close to, I would say, a world crisis, actually. A very problematical scenario. So we should give it everything we've got. So just keep on practicing or start practicing. You see, I don't have a start practicing problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a start practicing problem. I have a continuity problem. Insecurity problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a lack of support problem, I have a continuity problem. I have no lack of support problem whatsoever, none. I have no lack of support problem. I have a continuity problem. That's it. It's the only problem I have. I don't have a lack of support problem. I have a continuity problem. So you're saying this, you're training your mind, getting ready to have only this vision of only a faint, plausible potential for problems, but no actual problems. Okay? So this solves the continuity problem. This is what solves the continuity problem. So you're getting ready to have the continuity problem solved by denying, you know, any other problems. And be willingness, though, to accept the intermediate step, which is a potential for problems. Now, I can tell you through my experience in this world that most people the ego has trained and taught us, we've trained ourselves through what we call the ego teaching mechanism we've invented, the training mechanism we've invented, to make us overlook this intermediate step, this continuity problem, and make it seem like it's a blow to our pride to even think about this, and to insist, no, we got to do it abruptly, and we don't want any even potential for problems. What is that? See, that's beneath us. Forget it. And so we reject this. We reject it. That's what I found. Even among very advanced spiritual people, at least they think they're very advanced, because they're saying, no, I'm trying to jump back into reality. I want to get all problems disappear, boom, like that. No, it doesn't work that way. That's pride. That's egoic pride, knowing that we won't do that. It just generates a fear, and it just keeps us going, and we become suckers for the ego's glamorous delusions at that point. So most people will refuse, say, no, I don't even want a potential, even a faint, plausible potential for problems. I want them to vanish completely. I'm so tired of problems. And then they go, whoops, and then, you know, when they try to start to feel, you know, feel losing the problems, they panic. They say, no. Give me some real clever deceit so people will think that I'm enlightened, but I'm really not. And then you get all those people who are caught up in that trouble. You know, there's a lot of people caught up in that, actually. And I've tried to help them my whole life, and I'm still trying to. It's a very severe issue. But I think we're there. I think we're there. You know, it's just, that's just normal stuff here. That's just how the ego works. That's one of the ego's tricks. And there's a lot of tricks. The ego has a lot of tricks. All because of fear of the continuity problem, lack of understanding of it, because the ego doesn't want us to understand it. You ask, how come I haven't heard this stuff before? Because the ego doesn't want anyone to understand it. So it does everything it can to divert your attention off to something else. And it's very, very good at doing that. And it's extremely successful, actually. And that's why people just haven't even looked at it. But once you start looking at it, you start saying, hey, wait a minute. This is very reasonable. This is very pragmatic. This is what I've been looking for. This is the answer that I've been looking for, actually. And I overlooked it the whole time. I was trying to do too much. I was trying to leap straight back into reality, you know, problem freeness, from massive indoctrination into long-term habituated addiction to severe problematicalness. And I was just trying to like make this huge leap, and it was freaking me out completely. I just couldn't do it. And I say, oh, okay, so yeah, God's aware of this continuity problem, all right. And then you get the theory, understand that we projected, you know, onto God our own motivations, and God doesn't really have those motivations. There's no such thing as an angry, fearful, wrathful God at all. Those are projections entirely. Entirely. And then we say, okay, I can trust this more and more. You look at it more and more, and you gradually, it all becomes clarified for you. So clarity is not a bad thing. It might seem tough. The ego will say, oh, it's really tough. You know, you're losing all your fantasies and you're getting seeing clearly, you know, what the difficulties are in the situation. But in seeing it clearly, you also see what the remedy is clearly. So clarity, it goes both ways. Yeah, it sees the problem clearly, also sees the remedy clearly. And that's why it's a winner. That's why clarity is a winner. continue to be strict, continue to be adamant, continue to practice. Just do the best you can, and you'll find out it's better than you thought you could do. Don't worry about it. There's not some test. There's not some, you know, just do the best you can and move your comfort zone. Move your comfort zone. Yeah, it's not easy times ahead for anybody, for sure. So hedge the bets in your favor. Absolutely. Hedge them in your favor. Tilt things in your favor. Get the percentage in your favor. In other words, be prepared. Be prepared in your mind in the right way ahead of time. That's just a smart, responsible, pragmatic thing to do. That's it. It's not likely we're going to be able to stop the problems. It's potentially possible as far as the world goes. Potentially. I don't see that trend being a strong trend. And certainly have had a lot of warnings that there's going to be problems coming up. But anyway, don't trust the world situation as if it's going to take care of you. Trust the resolution of the continuity issue. Don't trust the world, the problems of the world, that they're going to be solved. Don't do it. Don't do it. That's a sucker play of the ego. Say, I don't have any world problems. I only have a continuity problem. And trust in the Holy Spirit to give you this vision, okay, of just faint, plausible potential for problems, but a smoothed out, sameness, where you're just resting in the cool shade of this everlasting shining bliss and calmness. Just rest in that shade. All right, very great. That's it.